Today I like to start our lecture again on chapter 7, which we're going to talking about the defections of structure. And the structure is going to be statically determined structure. And again, I should say that's going to be beam, that is going to be truss, and also it's going to be frame. And the second session, we are going to concentrate on the defection of the beam. And then we start what? We start with the construction of the beam. We may use the material such as steel, timber, or reinforced concrete. All of this material, they are deformable material. What I mean is, under the application of the force, the material can have some deformation. When you construct the beam by using the material like this, so under the application of the force, this is going to be deformable structure or deformable the beam. The way we going to show how the structure deform, we use the elastic curve. Elastic curve is a kind of the sketch of the axis that passes through the centroid, TROU, pass through the centroid of the section of the section. It's a sketch. Elastic curve of the axis that's passing to the centroid of the section when the beam or the structure subjected to the force. So when we like to sketch, when the structure is subjected to forces, so when you going to sketch the elastic curve, we may come to this first example. You can see this is a picture. Picture of what? Picture of a beam. Okay, this beam installed on two sides. One is the wall, another one is this wall. Under what we have here, we got to do what's so called modeling. By doing modeling, you got to consider the support of this beam. You may say this is going to be the pin, and this is going to be the roller. If this is pin, this is roller, you're going to have what? Under the application of the force transfer from the joints, there are the friction for the pin. You're going to have, let's say this is point A, A sub X and A sub Y. And let's say this is point B. This is going to be B sub Y. And then you may determine the reaction by using the free body diagram and using the equation of equilibrium. What the meaning of the reaction? Reaction is the force that prevents the beam from moving. Okay, so reaction used to prevent the beam, in this example, the beam from movement. So when there is A sub X, we will have the deflection at point A in X direction to be zero. That is the meaning of the reaction. And also, when you have A sub Y, the deflection at point A in Y direction is zero. And you may call back pin. Pin have no ability to resist the moment, so M sub A equal to zero. When M sub A equal to zero, there is the slope occur at A. So under the application of this force, let's say this is 2 meter, this is 2 meter, 2 meter, 2 meter. The force applied to it 10 kilonewton, 10 kilonewton, and 10 kilonewton. And under the beam is in symmetry, about its middle length or middle span, and is also subjected to symmetric load. So this beam will have what's so called symmetric beam. And due to the symmetric beam, under what I'm saying, under application of force, there is the slope occur over here. You draw the elastic curve, okay? The start of the elastic curve pass to the centroid of the section, okay? And then there is over here, theta sub A. Also for the roller, the roller have B sub Y. So the deformation or the displacement at point B in Y direction is zero. Then there is no axial force. If you do the summation of X sub X equal to zero, A sub X is zero. Okay, so since there is no axial force, V sub BX is zero. And then again, there is the M sub B of the roller is zero. When M sub B is zero, there is going to have theta sub B occur over here. Okay, no moment resistance. So the rotation or the slope can occur. And then due to the symmetry, we will have theta sub A equal to theta sub B. And then elastic curve is mean it's going to be continuous change, right? So from this one, there is going to have this kind of deformation. If you won't believe it, you just take this one and then you may push it like at the middle, okay? This is going to be the elastic curve of your beam, right? It's going to be continuous curve. And then since it is symmetry, so there is another side with the same shape of deformation. And based upon this consideration, this is going to be the point. Let's say this is point C. This is going to point with theta sub C equal to zero. You see, your beam bent like this. At the bottom over here, the slope is zero. And then what else do you have? The deformation that's occur over here is going to be V max, okay? This is what we have for what's so called symmetric beam. Now, let me move to another picture. The same one, let's say this is 2 meter, 2 meter, 2 meter, and 2 meter. The beam is what? It's in symmetry, but let's put the force over here to be 20 kilonewton, 10 kilonewton, and 10 kilonewton. What happened is the beam on the bottom will be different from the beam on the top, even though there is pin over here and it's roller over here. What the difference? If you consider again, the force on the size on close to point A is larger than the force that's close to point B. What happened is you will get again A sub Y, and this one going to be B sub Y, and you will have A sub Y larger than B sub Y. Okay, can you imagine that, right? When you have the beam like this, you put it near, let me take it down out. You put it like the force is close to here. So what you have is when this force apply near the thumb, the force over here, the force reaction over here will be larger than the deflection over here. Then what happened is the same consideration of the support come. What the V sub AX equal to zero, V sub AY equal to zero, but there is theta sub A over here. Now your theta sub A will be over here, and it's going to be larger than the theta sub B. Okay, due to the force, most of the force is in this size. Then the deformation of the beam will change. We will draw the elastic curve like this one. What happened is the first example, we have the force. We have the force at the middle. That is the bad zoom on this one. And then the deformation is symmetric. Okay. Now you move the force to this side, and then the deformation going to be like this. It's going to be unsymmetric. Theta on this side is larger than theta on this side. Theta A is larger than theta B. And then what happened is there's supposed to be a point over here. That's going to be slope equal to zero. And then this is going to be the point of V max. Okay, the point is V max. Now change for symmetric beam, the points of V max occur at the middle. For unsymmetric beam like this, the point of V max move to this location, and the point of V max have one very special character. The slope at that point must be zero. Okay, so this is the way we draw the elastic curve of the beam. We observe the support of the force of the beam. Okay, and then we use our image to connect the deformation. Okay, and then if we have this kind of beam, again, this is what? This is unsymmetric beam. When we draw the elastic curve, the line passing through the centroid of the beam. Okay, and then observe about it. This is roller. They have what? They have B sub Y. So deformation at B in Y direction is zero. Okay. And then over here, there is D sub Y. Deformation D sub Y is zero. And then there is D sub X. Deformation at DX equal to zero. And then summation of X sub X equal to zero. D sub X is zero. Since there is no axial force, so over here, V sub BX also equal to zero. And over here, M sub D won't be zero reaction. There is no moment reaction. M sub B won't be zero. And the force over here is large. I mean, B sub Y will larger than D sub Y. So we will have the rotation over here of theta sub B. And we will have the rotation or slope over here of theta sub D. And theta sub D is larger than theta sub D. Okay, now you got to link, imagine the curve that link between point D and point B, D and C. That is going to be the elastic curve. And then there is a point over here that has what? That has slope equal to zero. And that is going to be the point of maximum deflection. And then in the design, this is going to be less than the allowable deflection. And if there is no wall under it, that is going to be L over 250. If there is wall under the beam, this is going to be L over 360. If there is a wall, we allow going to be smaller than there is no wall. Okay, because if there is wall, the beam will compress on the wall and cause the crack on the wall. That's why we limit, okay, smaller allowable deflection if there is wall under the beam. Okay, this is a bit clearer, right? This called unsymmetric deformation of the beam. Now we move to this one. We have what? We have fixed support over here. And we have hinge, internal hinge over here. And we have roller over here. Under the application of the force, for sure, the structure is supposed to have this kind of deformation. But over here, at point A, you fix it. So the deformation won't be something like this. As the previous one, when you fix it, it's going to be something like this. Why? Because when you fix the support, there are going to be A sub Y. There are going to be A sub X. And then there is M sub A. And that's going to prevent the linear deformation in the Y direction. This is going to prevent linear deformation or deflection at point A in the X direction. And this is going to prevent the slope. Unlike this one, the moment over here is zero. So theta sub B. Moment over here is zero. This is theta sub B. This is moment over here is not zero. So there is no movement here. Okay. And then for this one, the same reasoning, we have V sub CY equal to zero because there is C sub Y. And since there is no axial force, so V sub CX equal to zero. Since over here M sub C is zero, so they're supposed to have this kind of theta sub C. Okay, now how you going to link between this one, no deformation at all, and this one with the slope? And also we have the hinge here. So the first one for sure, under the application of the force, be supposed to move to this one. Okay. And then there is what? There is the deformation between this one. You just link it like this. Okay. And then since you fix this point, significant, and there is the first applied kintuken. Over here, we have this kind of deformation. Okay, so over here, you have this kind of deformation. Then what you have is, this is going to be V sub B. And since this is internal hinge, okay, you may sketch the slope. Over here is going to be theta sub B left. And then the slope over here going to be theta sub B R. And due to the internal hinge, theta sub B L, theta sub B L may not equal to theta sub B R. Okay. If this is no hinge, thing gonna change. If this is no hinge, let me put it. If we have the same beam, but now this beam is statically indeterminate. Okay, by doing this one, Ajahn will show you easily. You fix it at one point, you roller it at this point. When you put it, it's going to have the shape something like this. What happened is, this is fixed. Okay, this can rotate, but now there is no hinge. Okay, since there is no hinge, the deformation will be smoother. Okay, there is going to have a point over here, and then they're supposed to have this kind of deformation, and the height over here is going to be what's so called inflection height. And then at point B over here, okay, what we have is, this is the continuous beam. Then the slope over here, and then the slope over here, they're going to be equal with theta sub B. Okay, this is the characteristic of internal hinge. And this is the characteristic of continuous beam. Okay, the slope of the continuous beam going to be the same. The slope at the hinge on the left and on the right may be the same, but most of the time is one. Okay, now let me move to this one. For the beam like this is called simple beam. For the simple beam, we may use what's so called the deflection table. We may use what's so called the deflection table to determine V and theta. And by using that, we use what? By using the method of superposition, You may recall that. But there is no deflection table for overhanging beam. Okay. And before we start further, let us consider this one. Over here, this is going to be pin. Over here is going to be roller. And you can see, for this application of the force, the beam will deflect something like this. Okay, the beam will deflect something like this. What we have is, there is the rotation occur over here. Okay, and if you notice this, there is the rotation occur over here. And also there is rotation occur over here. Then the deformation of this one will be something like this one. And what we have over here, this is going to be theta sub a. And this is going to be theta sub b since the material continuous. Theta sub b on the left equal to and in the same direction with theta sub b on the right. And now we have more, let's say this is C. What we have is going to have this deformation. This is V sub C. And then over here, if you draw a tangential line with this one, this is going to be theta sub C. We cannot show finding slope and deflection of this one by using the method of superposition. That means we going to study conjugate beam, okay, or moment area. But since moment area is the same as the conjugate beam, and the conjugate beam is better than moment area, so we will focus on conjugate beam. Now, let's see a bit further on this one. This beam is similar to this one, but this one is easy to imagine because this portion have no force. If you may imagine, this one should deflect something as before like this. No, it should not deflect as something like this because there is the force here. Okay. If there is the force here, if it's possible to have this kind of deformation, it's possible, right? Now, the problem is a bit bigger. You have the force over here at the end, okay? And then you also have the force in the middle. Now, the deformation of your beam is going to be a bit more complicated, but we don't know which way is going to occur. So the second method for drawing the elastic curve, okay, we use moment diagram to sketch the elastic curve. By doing moment diagram to draw the elastic curve, you guys supposed to know that if the member subjected to positive moment, the deformation is going to be concave upward, okay? In the opposite, if this one subjected to what so-called negative moment, the curve will be concave downward. Now, for this beam, you draw the moment diagram like this one, and then you have this portion to be positive. You have this portion to be negative, and there is a point of zero moment, okay? And then the curve change for concave downward to concave upward, and there is a point over here that's change the curve. Then if I follow this one, my curve over here will have the shape similar to this one. With this one is the point of zero moment, and then there is a portion over here. I will sketch the deformation to be something like this. Again, if the force over here is large, the curve will be like this. But since the force over here is only 12 times 1 compared to 12 times 2, the curve won't be like this. The curve will be something like this, okay? If you like to know exactly the curve is going to be, you got to compute for V, for AB we subsidy. If we subsidy is positive, it's up. If we subsidy is negative, it's going to be down. Okay. So sketching the elastic curve is not enough. You got to do the computation for the exact value of V sub C, whether it's up or whether it's down. In conclusion, there is the method that we learn from the previous subject called the method of superposition that use the deflection table, and the deflection cable come from the double integration method. The method here have some limitation for simple beam and for cantilever beam. If we have overhanging beam, we got to have another method that can be conjugate beam. That can be method of virtual work, first one. So we need to further study. Second, drawing the elastic curve, you got to observe how the structure subjected to the force and how the structure supported, pin, roller, fix. You also require to have imagine, okay, to connect all the observation together with the continuous elastic curve, okay? If not possible, like this example, we may use the moment diagram to help us to sketch the elastic curve. But sketching the elastic curve from the moment diagram can be the red line, blue line, or can be the black line, blue line. Because the exact value of the deflection is important to predict the black and the blue. That's why we require to determine the deflection also, not only for the sketch. Now, we have the point of zero moment, and we call this as the inflection point, okay? That's going to be inflection point. Inflection point is important. Important for what? Important for the consider for the reinforcement pattern of RC structure such as RC beam. Based on this observation, let's see if this is the RC beam. What we have is this is under what? Positive moment, the deformation is like this. If you're going to design the reinforced concrete have low tensile strength. You put the steel rod into the concrete, okay, to reinforce concrete. So based upon this one, you got to put the reinforcement over more reinforcement over this portion, okay, to resist what? To resist the bending moment, to prevent the deformation. And also on the top, whether it's on the black or on the red, it's subjected to negative moment. So on this portion, you got to put the reinforcement, okay, more over here conceptually. Then how many locks you going to put? You going to study that on the subject of RC design, okay? And not only that, there is what so called stirrup, okay? Stirrup is used to resist the shear. So there is large shear force in this portion, and also large shear force in this portion, and large shear force in this portion. So you got to put more stirrup in the portion of large shear force. And also over here, you got to put a lot of stirrup to prevent the shear failure of this one. For the area with small shear, the spacing between the stirrup can be larger than in this area. Okay, this is the way we use the elastic curve shear diagram, moment diagram to further your study. Okay, if you follow that one, we have this one. Then, following what we have before, we got to compute for deflection, right? We have the first method that we have discussed for double integration method. Based on the double integration method, we start with what's so called the elastic beam theory. On the elastic beam theory, if you have a beam and then the beam subjected to the force, you resist the movement by putting the pin and the roller. And then what you have is the beam gets some deformation and have the discussion over there. Okay, based upon this one, for any point at the distance x, the beam have this linear displacement we call v. Okay, and this v is function of x, and we say this is going to call deflection, or you may call it vertical displacement. That is going to be a very long name, right? And then again, at this point, there is the reference line here. And if you draw a tangent line over here, there is the slope occur on the left and on the right. The slope is going to be theta sub x equal to dv by dx. And this is going to be the slope. And then the curve that I draw like this one is going to represent what's so called curvature. The curvature mathematically is going to be d square v by dx square. And this type of curve is positive due to positive moment. And if it has this kind of curve, it's going to do to the negative moment. Then the elastic beam theory said the moment is going to be equal to EI times d square v by dx square. Larger moments produce larger curvature by using this relationship. And we call this fractional rigidity. Okay, E is going to be modulus of elasticity of the material. And then the I is going to be the moment of inertia of the section. Okay, now let us move to the PowerPoint and let me call you to the double integration again to review your knowledge. Over here, we have what? Elastic beam theory. We like to show it forward for the function of defection. So it is a requirement for us to determine this function. This is a function of what? This is a function of the bending moment. So call back to the subject of engineering static, or even the subject of theory of structure that we study in chapter 4. We start with a beam, okay, and then we what? Let's say the beam is subjected uniformly distributed load W. Let's say it's going to be 2 kN/m. This beam is 4 m. So based upon this one, we have A sub X equal to 0. We have A sub Y equal to B sub Y equal to 2 times 4 divided 2. It's going to be 4 kN. Okay. Right? You can do that, right? That is the old way of finding the reaction. You may say it is due to the symmetries of the beam. And then to determine this one, you got to cut this member at the distance of X. Then you have the free body diagram of this one is 4 kN, 2 kN/m. And for this one, you will have this one for M sub X. And also actually you have this one for V sub X, but we don't care about the V sub X because for the long beam, in our definition, in our assumption, we only consider the effect of the bending. Then you can use this free body diagram of the beam segment of the coordinate of X, and then you find M sub X. Okay, like this one, you take the moment over here, the M sub X will be 4 times X, 4X in this direction. And this one is going to be, follow this one, minus 2X times this one, X over 2, square over 2. You will have this one for 4X minus X square as the function. Then you have the function, and your function will be what? EI d square V by dx square equal to this one, 4X minus X square. You're going to solve for V. So you do the first integration. So this is going to be EI, and dV by dx equal to what? 4x square over 2 minus, this is bad. Take this one out. Minus x, this one x will be what? X cube over 3, right? And then plus C1. Every time you have the integration, you got constant of integration C1. Okay, now let us move to the second integration. If you do the second integration, you will find defection. This is going to be EIV equal to 4x cubed over 6 minus x power 4 over 12 plus C1x plus C2. Then there is the C1 and C2. That's we need to determine it further. We come to our beam. Our beam at this location, at what? At X equal to 0. Okay. We have what? We have the deflection equal to 0. So based upon this one, you may saw on this one, and also due to the elastic curve that we have discussed for the beam that's subjected to uniformly distributed loads, have the pin here and roller here, the elastic curve will be symmetry, okay, symmetry on this size, similar to this size, and then this point going to have Vmax, okay, and this point has spacing, when it have Vmax, theta is equal to zero, so at x equal to L over 2, slope is going to be zero. Now, based upon this one, the first one, this is zero. At x is zero, you may set from this one, zero equal to zero minus zero plus zero plus C2. So based upon this one, C2 is zero. Okay. And then from the condition over here, now EI times slope. So zero equal to this L over 2, 4 over 2 is to be 2. And then L over 2 square minus 1/3 L over 2 cube. Okay. And then plus C1. You can solve for C1. And then when you put C1 into this equation, you put C1 into this equation, you get the result. Okay. That is going to be the procedure. And then we have this one. Again, follow what I did. Before this one, we put this is to be 2 kilonewton per meter. You call it. It's going to be 4 kilonewton, right? So this is going to be 2 times 4 x over 2 minus 2 over 2 x square. We have this one for 4 x minus x square. Okay. And then I recall this one back is going to be m sub x equal to 4x minus x square. Okay. And then we go a bit further. We integrate it the first time. We integrate it the second time. The same one. Okay. As I show you guys. For C1 related to slope. Okay. There is a point over here, let's have the maximum deflection slope equal to zero at x equal to, when you measure from here to here, L over 2 again. Okay. And then for the deflection, you say over here, you come to this point at x equal to zero, deflection equal to zero. If you don't like it, you may say, x equal to L, deflection equal to zero. You may use anyone you like. Okay. But this one will be more easier. And then you do the same thing. You got C2 equal to zero. Okay. I did show you guys already. How about C1? You will get the result like this. Okay. For my calculation, this is going to minus 2. And 4 cubed over 24. You may have this one to be a value, right? This is going to be 12. Okay. This is going to be square. This is going to be 3. It's going to be 16 divided by 3. And you can see C1 is a constant. And then you put everything together, you get the equation. And then this kind of equation appear in what? Appear in the deflection table, right? And again, from the deflection table, you may use this by what so called the method of superposition. And then following the method of superposition, for example, this one. You may use method of superposition by two assumptions. First, under the application of the force, the behavior of the material of the beam is going to be linear elastic. That means sigma is less than sigma sub y. And then there is the second one, the small deformation. All of this subject, you will get this one to be very small. Okay, maybe just 10 millimeter, 20 millimeter. If you calculate it, you get deformation 500 millimeter. You wrong for sure. Okay, or you may get the slope to be something 10 minus 3 radian. If you get 1 radian, 0.1 radian, your result wrong for sure. Okay, do another calculation. Because we talking about this small deformation, Ajahn cannot decide the problem violate this kind of assumption. Okay, then from the deflection table, you may separate this beam into two beam. And for V sub C1, you may go back to this picture. You determine the deflection over here based upon this equation with x equal to L over 2. And again, for the second one, you can determine V sub C2 is going to be over here. Going back to the deflection table, this is going to be your deflection, okay? You may use this equation with x equal to L over 2. And then if you use this, you will get this equation, okay? And then if you use this one, you will get this equation. Then you just combine this equation and this equation Sx equal to L over 2. You will get the result of here, V sub C equal to V sub C, and then 1 plus V sub C 2. Okay, and then we have this examination already from the previous course. So this course we go a bit more complex structure. Okay, and you also have this kind of calculation for cantilever beam. But when we go out of the deflection table, you have overhanging beam. Like you're going to work it on the homework, you got to use the method of virtual work. You got to use the method of conjugate beam or the method of virtual work for solving this equation. Ajahn, can these two equations solve the beam subjected to uniformly distributed load? Yes, but mathematics will be very complicated. So for our study to reduce the complication of the mathematics, you may see most of the problem we solve on this course is due to the point load. But in the past, Ajahn also showed you guys on the problem with uniformly distributed load. If you're curious about this thing, okay, you may go to my video clips on my YouTube and you may see some example. But I like to limit it for our examination. Frankly talk with you, I will focus on the point load, okay? Because I like to reduce the complication of the mathematics, okay? Like you focus on the method of conjugate beam more, okay and also like you guys to focus on the method of virtual work อาจารย์ which method can be used in the examination you may use any method you like but one method okay will be better than another one so it's under your engineering judgment okay let me introduce you like this and like you take you guys to this conjugate beam and then we will take 5 minute break on the conjugate beam this method developed by Ottomar you may recall what so called more circle also developed by Ottomar helping us to find the principal stress and its an associate angle maximum shear and associate angle easier you don't need to solve the equation we use a Mohr circle Otto Mohr also helping us for determining the slope and deflection Otto Mohr succeeded with what we know about what so called the relationship between uniformly distributed load W and shear and also bending moment you may recall this one right and then I will recall about it very quick simple one let's start talking about the beam like this one has 10 kilonewton and 2 meter and 2 meter okay we may determine the reaction of this one pretty quick 5 kilonewton recall from that right about a sub x is going to be 0 and then basis up on this one we draw the shear diagram with x equal to 0 here 2 here and 4 here and basis on our lead chip when the force act at this point a okay this is v kilonewton this is going to up for 5 kilonewton and then w here is 0 from this one the slope here is going to be 0 recall from that right you say dv by dx equal to 0 and this is going to be plus 5 and 10 take it down over here it's going to be minus 10 plus 5 it's going to be minus 5 and again w here is 0 you said dv by dx equal to 0 5 kilonewton close this one then you really call this relationship right to draw the shear diagram and also for the moment diagram you do the same thing you put this one for the moment kilonewton meter and this one for the x meter and then there is pin and roller at the two end so moment here is 0 moment here is 0 and then the distance here is 0 2 and 4 and you have dv by dx equal to v is plus 5 so they always have slope over here dm by dx equal to plus 5 and then you may calculate the value of moment over here you have what dm equal to v dx you integrate it from a to c integrate it from a to c m sub c minus m sub a equal to integration area of v diagram from a to c okay so the moment over here m sub c this one minus 0 equal to the area of shear diagram between these two points is going to be 5 times 2 so m sub c is 10 kilonewton meter okay that is going to be the point over here with 10 then the dv by dx is going to be minus 5 d m by dx going to be minus 5. Slope is going to be down, and then you get the shear diagram like this. Now, more take this one, okay? And more use a simple mathematics. V is going to be dv by dx. More said, if you like it again, take this dm by dx, okay? Substitute for the v. And then rewrite this equation, more get this d square m by dx square equal to minus w. Okay, now more come to the elastic curve. Okay, this is symmetry. The left and the right, they are the same shape. On this elastic curve, more have this one for v. Okay, and then for this v, more said, it's going to have the slope dv by dx, and it's going to have the curvature d square v by dx square. Now, starting with this equation, elastic beam theory. And then more work back to this torsion, okay, by writing d square v by dx square into this form of differential equation. And then more work back to the theta. Now, there are observations. First, the top portion, this is for the real beam, okay? And the bottom portion is going to be for the conjugate beam, in which if you change, okay, the moment diagram and you put it into what's so called elastic weight, then your elastic weight can be compared to W with the opposite direction. This is negative, this is positive. Okay, so note it, elastic weight always opposite to W. W point downward to the beam, right? W point downward to the beam. So elastic weight always point outward of the beam. Remember this one, important. Then when you do the elastic weight act up on the conjugate beam, you use the same concept of the engineering statics. You analyze the conjugate beam. Okay, you analyze the conjugate beam. You get the shear, okay, on the conjugate beam. The shear on the conjugate beam, you see the red, okay? Sorry, you see the green? The shear on the conjugate beam will be the slope on the real beam. Okay, so we palm on conjugate beam will be slope on the real beam. You do the same thing of the analysis now. You determine what's so called M palm. You determine M palm on the conjugate beam. Okay, you will get the friction on the real beam. Ajahn confusing. Start with this one. Okay, we start with the beam subjected to the load W. And I said load W have the downward or point into the beam direction. Then you start with first one. You determine the reaction. You use what? You use the free body diagram, and then you use the equation of equilibrium. This is going to be real beam. Okay. You use what? You use the engineering statics concept. Second one, you draw V diagram. Okay. And then also you draw moment diagram. Use the same concept that I did. Then there are important. The third step, you're going to convert real beam to conjugate beam. Okay. The first one, let's say this is A, it's going to be A palm. This is B, this is going to be B palm. The moment, any point over here, M, you come to this point over here, and then you divide it by EI. Okay, this is going to be elastic curve. So we're going to have the conjugate beam subjected to elastic weight. We said this is going to be conjugate beam. Okay. And then under the application of the force, what Ajahn have is the beam here will have this kind of elastic curve. And then you may have this symmetric elastic curve. And then you start by determining the reaction. So the first step, you determine reactions of conjugate beam A sub Y palm and this one B sub Y palm. And due to the symmetry, okay, of the elastic weight and conjugate beam, A sub Y palm will equal to B sub Y palm. Okay. And then if you a bit further to the consideration, you cut a point over here, and then this is going to be point A palm. And point A palm is subjected to the force of A sub Y palm. Okay. And at the cutting point, okay, there is going to have the moment and the shear. But the moment is zero because you cut at the pin. Okay. So V over here is downward. V plus A sub Y palm equal to zero. V is going to be minus A sub Y palm. And the previously we said what? V, let's say V palm. Okay, V palm. V palm equal to minus A sub Y palm. This is equivalent to slope at point A. This is going to be theta sub A negative have this clockwise direction. Now, if you move a bit further to this portion of point B palm, and then this portion subjected to the force over here, B sub Y palm, and then you use the same sign convention that you have the moment here. This is downward. This is upward. This is V palm. Let's say V sub B palm. You will get V sub B palm equal to B sub Y. And this equivalent to theta sub B over here. It is positive counterclockwise. Okay. And then this is theta B. Since this equal, so theta A is equal to theta b okay prove right due to the symmetry of this beam okay and then what you have a sub y this is going to be the a sub y and this is going to be b sub y prime okay it's the shear then if you plot it you have the point of zero shear on conjugate beam so v prime equal to zero that's equivalent to the slope at x equal to l over 2 the slope over here is zero because this is v max again v max equivalent to maximum m prime over here okay and then this is pin m sub a prime is going to be zero so v sub a is zero this is roller m sub v prime equal to zero v sub b equal to zero corresponding to this point and this point this one m max equal to v max corresponding to this point so the theory said based upon this kind of observation for Professor Moore first theorem said the slope at a given point on the real beam theta a is equal to the shear force at that point v sub a prime or theta b equal to v sub b prime then the second theorem said for the deflection at what at this point for example maximum is going to นะครับ is going to equal to the bending moment at that point of what of the conjugate beam in conclusion you have the real beam okay you draw the moment diagram you change the moment diagram into the elastic weight you change the real beam into the conjugate beam you analyze conjugate beam you get the shear on conjugate beam equal to slope on the real beam you analyze conjugate beam you get the bending moment on conjugate beam is deflection on the real beam okay that's going to be the theory and this one is more complicated let me prove it into the example oh before we go to the first example the application of the conjugate beam require a bit on this point also okay from the previous one I didn't change the pin and the roller of the real beam and the conjugate beam they are the same there are reason behind it but I like you guys to consider the concept of the conjugate beam support here this is the real beam okay on the real beam this is fixed support and at the fixed support v sub a equal to zero and then theta sub a equal to zero then for the conjugate beam v prime sub a equal to zero m prime sub a equal to zero okay which point of the structure have no shear and no moment this is going to be free end so fixed end will change to
to free end okay now at this point this is free end free end have we sub c that mean over here we need to have m sub c palm won't be zero and there is theta sub c that mean over here v sub c palm won't be zero so free n change to fixed n you may read it by yourself in conclusion to change the real beam into the conjugate beam fixed support change to free support of the real beam change to fixed end okay then we come to the conclusion over here fix change to free change to fix let me move a bit to this one external support let's say external pin and external roller over here v is equal to zero and then there is the slope won't be zero so when the slope won't be zero over here v palm won't be zero when the deflection is zero what is mean m palm equal to zero what kind of support have the shear and have no moment is the pin and roller so that's why pin and roller external pin and roller they are the same because over here m palm is zero because over here there is v palm equal to the reaction so the second set external pin external roller they are the same both real beam and conjugate beam okay let me move a bit more internal hinge okay Ajahn mentioned about the internal hinge before over here okay internal hinge have what internal hinge can move from point B to point B palm so internal hinge has deflection for conjugate beam m palm of internal hinge won't be zero and then there is the slope that occur in the internal hinge so v palm won't be zero what kind of support have both shear and moment is internal support okay and then by the same concept internal support change to internal hinge first set fix change to free change to fix okay second set external pin external roller the same third set internal hinge change to internal pin or internal roller and internal pin and internal roller change to internal hinge okay that's going to be simple to remember let us apply this one before we take a break on this one external pin external roller they are the same okay that's why I start with this one then fix over here change to free over here change to fix okay over here going to be the same pin over here going to be fix okay here
is going to be internal hinge.
Okay. Now, let's, this one going to be what? Right? And how about this one? Okay. And how about this one? Right? So you have this one. External roller, internal hinge, and free. And the last one, this is going to be free. This is going to be free. This is can be internal hinge or pin. This is going to be internal hinge or pin. Okay, then this one pin roller is going to be pin and it's going to be roller. Then this one going to be internal hinge. This one. And this one internal hinge is going to be internal pin. Okay. This one the same. This one the same. This one change to internal hinge. This one change to internal hinge. Okay. And this one going to be free. This one going to be free. And this one going to be internal hinge. Ajahn, there is no support. Don't worry. Elastic weight will take care of everything. Okay. It's not following static. Don't worry. Elastic weight will taking care of everything. And then it's going to be free. And it's going to be free. Okay. Now, the last one before we take 5 minute break. Fix, change to free. Free, change to fix. Okay. This is going to be free. This is going to be free. And this is going to be the same pin and roller. Okay. And this one, the same pin. This one, the same roller. And this one will change to internal hinge. Okay. This one will the same pin. This one will change to fix. And this one will change to hinge. Okay, this is going to be free. This is going to be free. Internal hinge, internal roller. Okay, the last one, the same, the same. Okay, the same, the same. And this one will hinge. This one will be internal pin. This is going to be internal roller. And then hinge. Okay. And that's all for that one. And I should take 5 minute break. Let me start the second session. In conclusion, the procedure of the analysis of the conjugate beam, we will start with the analysis of the real beam to get the bending moment diagram. So if you are weak on the chapter 4, I'd like you guys to go back, review how to draw the shear diagram, how to draw the bending moment diagram. Since the first step wrong, the next step will be wrong. Okay. Then we convert the bending moment diagram into the elastic weight by divided the moment diagram by what so called fractional rigidity. And then we also need to convert the support of the real beam into the conjugate beam. For example, fix change to free and also free change to fix the roller. And the pin, you just keep it to be the roller and the pin. Internal hinge, you change to
internal roller or internal pin. Internal roller or pin. You change to internal hinge. Okay, that is the way we change it. Then, by using this one, the elastic weight always have the opposite direction of the weight W. It's always point out of the conjugate beam. Okay, and then you analyze the beam. The shear force we have will equivalent to the slope of the real beam. The bending moment M palm on the conjugate beam will equivalent to the deflection of the beam. Follow theorem number one and theorem number two. And since the time limited, let me move you guys to this example first. Okay, to do the hand calculation. Let me do this problem. We have overhinging steel beam. That means we cannot use method of superposition to solve this problem. And then they ask us to determine slope at A, slope at B, slope at C, deflection at C, deflection at D. I like you guys to think about this one. And then if you possible, you may use your ruler and pen and those kind of things. Under the application of the force, the beam will deform something like this. Okay, that means you can draw the elastic curve of this one easily. By doing this one, you may notice the curve like this. That means point C will move to somewhere, let's say, over here. This point going to be the same over here, no movement. And then over here, they're supposed to have some rotation. Again, over here, they're supposed to have some rotation. And then over here, there is no movement, the pin, but they're supposed to have the slope. So based upon this circuit, I'm pretty sure you guys should be able to draw the elastic curve of this beam properly. Then what you have over here is going to be the slope here is going to be theta sub A. And then this slope in the clockwise direction, they are equal. They are theta sub B. And then over here, they're supposed to be theta sub C. And the deformation from here to here is going to be V sub C. Okay, how about D? D is at this middle. So over here, we should have the deflection V sub D. And also over here, okay, we also have the slope theta sub D, if you like to. Now, we start our first step. We draw the free body diagram of the beam and compute the reaction. So what we have is 555 meter subjected to the force of 60 kilonewton. Then we have this one over here as the point B, this one as the point A. A is the pin, A sub X, summation of X sub X equal to zero. A sub X is zero. If you trying to take the moment over here, 60 clockwise, so B sub Y is going to be counterclockwise. This is 10 meter. This is 5 meter. Then if you take the moment over here, this one clockwise, so the force over here must be counter clockwise. So this is upon this summation of the moment about A equal to zero. Counterclockwise B sub y times 10 is going to be equal to 60 times 15. So our B sub y is going to be 60 times 15 divided by 10. That is going to be 90 kilonewton. Then summation of F sub y equal to zero. Downward is positive. A sub y plus 60 downward equal to 90. So A sub y going to be 30 kilonewton. This is 30 kilonewton. This is downward 30 kilonewton. This is upward 90 kilonewton. The shear diagram. This is X meter 0, 5, 10, 15. And this is going to be V in kilonewton. So based upon this one, we have 30. So let's say 3 millimeter minus 30. And then no W, dV by dx equal to 0. This is going to be minus 30. Then you have this is 90. So it's upward plus 90 minus 30 is going to be plus 60. Then dV by dx equal to 0. No W. This is plus 60 and down here. Okay. Now we draw the second one. We draw the shear diagram and moment diagram. Okay. This is point of pin zero. This is Vn is zero. 0, 5, 10, 15, x meter. And again, this is going to be m in kilonewton meter. What we have is the shear. So dm by dx equal to minus 30. This one will go down like this one. What is going to be the moment over here? M sub B over here, minus zero is going to be this one. It's going to be minus 30 times 10. M sub B going to be minus 300 kilonewton meter. So put this one into 10 millimeter. You have this one, the slope here, the slope here, minus 30. And this one, minus 300. Then slope here, dm by dx equal to plus 60. And this is zero. So this is going to be your moment diagram. And then third, convert m diagram to what's so called elastic weight. And convert real beam to conjugate beam. The next going to be this one. By doing this one, we have the area over here. Since the beam that we are interested has the external pin, for the external pin, the beam still have this external pin. For the free end, we got to change from the free end to fixed end. For the internal roller, we got to change it to internal hinge. And then elastic curve, we have this downward to represent the negative. Okay, and then this is going to be 300 divided by EI. And then this is going to be your conjugate beam. And you should understand the elastic weight always point out of your conjugate beam. Change this one to A palm, this one to D palm, this one to B palm, and this one to C palm. Then we analyze the conjugate beam. We analyze conjugate beam to find what? To find shear. If you have shear on conjugate beam, you get slope. If you have bending moment on conjugate beam, you get deflection. Okay, so go back to this one. You got to have V sub A harm. You got to have V sub B harm. V sub C harm. This one, M sub C harm. This one, M sub D harm. You got to separate the beam because the beam has internal hinge, and then you do this separation. You have this first portion of the beam to be A harm, D harm, B harm, and follow what we have on chapter 4. Okay, this is pin, right? You may have this one going to be A sub Y palm, this one to be A sub X palm. Summation of X sub X equal to zero for sure. Elastic weight only have vertical direction, no horizontal. And then follow with this one. Over here is the pin. You will have this one going to be B sub Y palm. And then again, B sub X palm is zero. Then following this portion of what? Of B palm, C palm, you have this kind of elastic curve. Again, this is 300 over EI, 300 over EI. The B sub Y palm now point this way for this portion. And then at the C, you have this one, C sub Y palm, and then M sub C palm. And again, M sub C palm over here will be this one. Okay, C sub Y palm will be this one. Okay, and V sub B palm will equivalent to B sub Y palm. And this one is equal to A sub Y palm. Now, we start our consider which one? Which one we should start? We should start with the A palm, D palm, B palm. Consider the free body diagram of A palm, D palm, B palm. Okay, we may take the summation of the moment. Let's say B palm equal to zero. Then when you take this one, this is positive. A sub Y palm, this is 5 meter, 5 meter times 10. Okay, rotate in this direction. And then there is the resultant force over here, 1/2 × 10 × 300/EI. This one is gonna be 1,500 EI. So equal to 1,500 EI. Rotate on this one to be 10/3. So times 10/3, 10, 10. You get A sub Y palm to be 500 over EI. And then from the elastic curve, you have this one to be 500 over EI direction counter clockwise. Then you go to summation of F sub Y equal to zero. Upward is positive. B sub Y time plus 500 over EI. And then is equal to this one is downward 1500 EI. So your B sub Y palm will be 1000 over EI. That is two times this one. Then you come over here. This is 1000 over EI. Rotation in this direction opposite to theta sub A. That's from elastic curve. That's why elastic curve is important. Okay. Now you get this one to be 1000 over EI. This is 1000 over EI. Again, consider the free body diagram of B palm, C palm. If you do the summation of F sub Y equal to zero, upward is positive. C sub Y palm upward. This downward, and this is going to be the resultant force. One half, this one, 5 meter, 300 over EI. This is going to be 1,500 divided to 750 over EI. So C sub Y is going to be 1,000 over EI plus 750 over EI. It's going to be 1,750 over EI. Okay, so slope over here, 1,500 over EI. And this is going to be in this rotation, you have this rotation. Okay, this one, you have this rotation. Now, you do the summation of the moment at C palm equal to zero and put this one to be positive. M sub C palm rotate this way. This rotate in the opposite 750 over EI. The distance from here to here is 2/3 of the 5. So time 10, 2/3 time 5 time 10 divided by 3, and then plus 1000 over EI time 5. So this is going to be 7500 over EI, and this equivalent to what we sub C. So this is going to be 7500 over EI and downward. Now you have deflection at D. So by the time being, cut it over here, and then you have this one A palm, D palm. This is going to be the moment M sub D, M palm sub D, the moment at this section. So over here, you have this one and this one. This is 5 meter. This is 300 divided by 10. So this is going to be something divided by 5. So for sure, that is going to be 150 over EI. And then we have what? We have A sub Y palm. A sub Y palm, we have it before, 500 over EI. And then we have this side convention M sub D palm. And this one, V sub D palm, summation of the M sub D palm equal to zero. M sub D palm rotate in this direction. And this one is one half time 5 and this is 150 over EI. This is 375 over EI plus 375 over EI times this distance 5 over 3. And then the rotation of this one is in opposite direction, 500 over EI times 5. You get M sub D times equivalent to V sub D. That is going to be, I get what? 1,875 EI. And then this is upward. Okay. The result over here is upward. Okay. This one to be 1,750 over 18. Sorry. 1,875 and upward. And then if you prefer summation F sub Y equal to 0, downward is positive. V sub D palm downward plus 375 over EI. And then it's gonna be 500 over EI. So V sub D palm is going to be 125. Right, over EI. That is going to be the rotation over here. Okay, and if you notice, the rotation going to be in this direction. This is the O examination that I like you guys to know about it. I didn't touch the uniformly distributed load because the moment diagram will be curved, then the calculation going to be complicated. So we focus on point load. To get the concept, okay. For further application, you may do it further for uniformly distributed by yourself. Okay, that's all for today. And we have the makeup class tomorrow from 7 to 9. And possible, I ask you to join me over here, better than online for sure. But if not, it's okay. Okay, I will teach you over here. Thank you.